Мне вот интересно, а вы с Мишей договорились, чтобы специально в ту же неделю доклады делать, или так просто
Да,
пошло?
не, ну как он на самом деле Джувин давно меня как бы уговаривал, а я говорил, что это все старое и прочее. А потом, ну, стал он меня спрашивать, а как вот Миш Шифман? Ну, я говорю, ну, спросите у него. В общем, кончилось тем, что на двух, ну, а тогда мне уже было неудобно отказываться дальше. То есть это был мы в пакете, да, это правильно. Ну, это так и было, да. Но, Джувин, you are here?
Yes, I'm here. And
Sorry, Jovan, we didn't mean to hijack into Russian. It's just
Yeah, no, I
yeah.
just trying to check the whether I can share
Yeah, you
screen.
can share screen, please. No, yeah, you can
So
have
is
your.
it, I can try it now?
You can, yeah, you can. Yes. Thank you.
Okay. I do not see it shows. It shows something else. Sure. Start screen. Something. How I can move to a different window in the share screen? Can you tell me?
So the easiest, Arkady, is if you stop sharing and then just do it
Stop sharing.
again. Yes, for now, just this is what I would
And
do. I
it
would.
says new share. Let's say new share. Okay.
There should be like a red button saying stop sharing, and then I'd
So
suggest.
stop share. Yeah.
And
Okay.
now if
And
you
mouse
move
again.
perhaps. And when you click this time on share screen, you could choose which window, which screen to share.
Okay, now you
Oh,
can see
beautiful.
it, right?
Yes, now we can see it.
Okay, that's the window.
Right. Right now we are still not seeing the present, like what happens if you click play? Would we see the
I'm going. Yeah.
okay. No, I just want to see if sometimes that may or may not work.
I'll be
Beautiful.
back, so feel free to take a control and please
Oh, no,
feel
I
free to help.
didn't. Sorry, I
No,
didn't mean to take control.
please help. Yeah, please
thanks for
help.
the help.
I'll
What?
appreciate if someone can take the position of a host.
Is it visible?
Or maybe you can introduce Akani. If you want to. I do want to speak some Russian, but I'm not sure when it's good
No,
enough.
but look, you even translated, everything into Russian. But I could kind of edit your Russian. It's this I can. You can speak some Russian indeed, Julian, or it's just some translator.
I do try to learn,
No, I
Yeah.
wonder if you can speak Russian indeed.
Not fluent.
Okay. Yeah,
Mia Mia Sao Yana bus not come yourself.
because there in the translation I could correct some stuff, but it was clearly for me. So I when you wrote in Russian. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, can I ask you, where is Novokuznetsk? Sorry, I was just looking at your at your biography.
You know where Novosibirsk is, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's more to the south, and it is like maybe 400 kilometers. It's direction to Altai mountains, but no, I mean, probably a little bit southeast, right? And as I said, it's kind of so on the larger map, I mean, in the slide scale, you know, Novosibirsk is kind of the east corner of Kazakhstan, not that far. So when we were going to Altai, for example, sometimes we finish our trip in Kazakhstan, through Altai Mountains. Yeah, so this Kazakhstan part of Altai.
I see. So, Arkady, this I didn't know. So, did you do mountaineering or?
Some kind of touristic stuff. So, no, I went to Pamir as well, but I mean, a few times, but no, it's not very, very regular. But in this Akademgorodok, you know, to go somewhere, I mean, in mountains was kind of very much widespread. So, mm-hmm. you know, people were much more involved. But say Tian Shan, Pamir, Altai was relatively not far. So say for example, it was like standard was say this May holidays where it's a long period, right? And in Altai it is still a lot of snow high in the mountains there. So it's a combination of different stuff. So, yeah, so it's this I remember well. Yeah. No, Misha appeared.
Yeah,
hi. Yeah, so maybe Misha, maybe it should be just two of us. Yeah, to talk to recollect all stuff. Yeah.
And we will wait for one more minute.
Okay.
And I will introduce Professor Benstein. And Andrew, you may be able to help if you want to translate to Russian. But who will see?
If you'd like to, but yeah.
But my voice is loud enough because I can change the loudness if it's not enough. It's okay. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It is clear. Yeah, it's good. Maybe you can start. Well, welcome everyone, Robert Bajolovic. Welcome to Harvard CMSA seminar. Robert Bajolovic, the Harvard CMSA seminar. It is my great honor to introduce Professor and welcome Professor Arkady Benstein. Diamanya Boshal Yashist, previous Robert, Professor Arkady Benstein. Professor Weinstein grew up and studied at Novokuznetsk, Russia, and then he also did his work in Booker Institute of theory, nuclear physics in Novosibirsk. And he had done serious many contributions to quantum field theory and got numerous awards, including Sakurai Prize in 1999 and Pomeruchuk Prize in 2005, Julia West Award in 2014, and Dira Medal Prize in 2016. And he certainly tells a lot about his contribution to quantum field theory and physics, but this prize are not enough to reveal the way I think how Professor Einstein working on physics and his view on physics. I especially feel he's my role model. He's very generous in the sense when he attends seminars, he is really curious, asking a lot of questions, especially my seminar 2 weeks ago. I really feel his enthusiasm about physics, and I think that's a bet for young people to, you know, to learn from him, this attitude. So today he will be speaking about use of the Wilson operator expansions in gauge theories, and let's welcome Professor Einstein. Please take over.
Thank you. Thank you, Julian. I should say some kind of special thanks to him, not only for his presentation of me, but also he would regret it, but he was very insistent trying to involve me in talking, and I did try to resist, saying that the stuff I'm going to talk today, in particular, it's a very old one, and in this sense, it's not in the style of this CMSA seminar, because normally it's kind of novel ideas were presented, and but then he still managed to get it together with Misha Schiffman as a package, and then I could not resist anymore. I hope that
thank you very much.
But I hope that people who are present will follow an example of Julian, in the sense that for me it would be very valuable if you would interrupt me, because then it would be much easier for me to talk, because I'm kind of more inclined to argue or to discuss rather than giving a lecture. So you will see it. But I still like to start with apologies that I'm presenting very old stuff. Maybe still some interest could be that some kind of not very clear question could be asked, not very clear pieces could be discussed. So I very much hope to active, interruptions. Okay, so please do it. Okay, so you see the name, the title of the talk, and I put, two institutions, University of Minnesota and Covey Institute in Santa Barbara, because I kind of, when it was 2018, I moved from Minnesota to California, and there I associated with Covey Institute, so was spending a lot of time inside of the institute when it was possible, and still continue. So while technically I'm kind of this emeritus in Minnesota, so Minnesota is the main destination. Okay, let's see. Why does it move? Next slide. Just a moment. So here you can see the photo of Ken Wilson, that my title is about this Wilson operator expansion, and Well, a lot of stuff was discussed even before Ken came in the field. He was the one who made a very clear presentation, and it was, I think, was a crucial change of you know, of understanding because of him. But say, if I will recollect some kind of precocious appearance of this kind of operator expansion earlier in Russia, then I would be recollecting, say, for example, Pokrovsky and Potashinsky, when they started this, what they call fluctuation theory of phase transition. And it was beginning of 60s, I was still a student, but I was at their seminars back then. Not understood very much what they're talking about, but it was clearly some kind of novel idea. But later on, I was interacting with Sasha Polyakov, and his idea were again very, close to this further development. Okay, but at the West, it was some number of people like Adanov and others, but I mentioned this. Russian contributors to this part, and it was very early on. So now I'm trying to discuss this kind of this general construction, which is due to Wilson, that we are starting with some kind of local Lagrangian density. In crucial point that it is kind of introduction of scale. So when we are saying local Lagrangian, it means that level of locality is regulated by this UV cutoff, which is denoted by capital M. So it means that you do not know what would be distances less than 1/m. And we are saying, writing kind of local Lagrangian density at distance, which corresponds to the distances larger than 1m, this would be initial data for development of the theory. Okay, so it means that all distances shorter than 1m are already entered coefficient of Lagrangian, which is written as kind of sum of local operators. But the quantity which are observable are associated with taking like stuff like say path integral which uses action given by this Lagrangian, and this path integral which contains M as ultraviolet cutoff, produces observable amplitudes or in correlators, and there this taking matrix measurement, which shown by brackets, is corresponds that at this step you are counting all distances which are larger than 1/m. Okay. So then, as I said, this Lagrangian, which represented as a sum of local operators at the point M, you can try to do the following procedure. Now you're trying to introduce a new Lagrangian corresponding to a different UV cutoff, M tilde, under conditions that it is Lagrangian which produces the same observable amplitude as the first one. So it is just definition that matrix element of this path integral for this origin, first Lagrangian M gives you the same result as Lagrangian with M tilde, and in this way you are finding, but M tilde is some cutoff which is lower than original one. So you're finding how coefficient in operator coefficient in the tilde Lagrangian related to original coefficient. Okay, so in this way you are discussing the running of operator coefficient as function of normalization point M. Okay, and why this kind of a very clear presentation of approach is important, that You know, maybe because of my old age, I remember how it was discussed before. So in this way, history was associated with quantum electrodynamics and to the defining randomization procedure in quantum electrodynamics, and it was this this BPSZ procedure of defining. So people did not talk about operator product expansions. They talked about a possibility to hide this infinity by counter terms, right? In Vincent approach is much simpler because you are saying that you have original operator coefficient at some the point M, and you do not need to think about randomizability of the theory, whatever, just original coefficient. Then you are trying to find out what would be coefficient for the lower UV cutoff, and it's possible for any kind of original Lagrangian, don't mind whether it's normalizable or not. What is randomizability when need for it to find out how many operators are involved in this randomization? If you you have operator of this limited dimension up to four in four dimensional theory, then you can check that you know this running would be not involving new operators. If it's not a normalizable theory, it would be operators of higher dimension which could show up there. However, you still can do the same procedure of running, but the question would be then you know, where it goes, what are new operators, what are their coefficient. Okay, so in this sense, when people are talking about validity of proof of operator product expansion, in this approach, it does not make sense because this operator expansion is built in, right? You're starting from local Lagrangian, so it's local. Okay, it's written in terms of operators. Then you're discussing running of operator coefficient, and you do not need to prove anything. In this sense, I think that it is some issue. I think that in terms of teaching people to quantum field theory, this is still missing. So while you can see, say, Peskin book, for example, that some discussion of operator product expansion, but not the way that it is kind of based on this idea of operator expansion. And I think that the person who kind of realized it early on was Joe Palczynski, who realized that you know this. This idea that in this way, I think that it should be work a different way. Of course, it's kind of involves some complication, which I probably wouldn't discuss in the detail. But still, you see that in this way, normal Feynman rules when people doing this calculation by perturbation theory and using loops or whatever. What I'm trying to emphasize that it's not the same as calculating operator coefficients because you need to do this. I'm not sure. I cannot see my cursor. So, there is only one equation at this slide. So this equation implies that it's not immediate relation between the coefficient between M and M tilde, because each time you should go all the way down to compare. So unlevel, you know, to unlevel distances, short distance from large distances. And there is no kind of perturbation procedure formulated just in terms of running of coefficient. Which way you regularize the theory in infrared is not that crucial because, say, for particular our application were mostly in QCD. In QCD, the theory is singular in infrared, so coupling becomes strong, right? But But for coefficient, which are short distances, which way you utilize infrared doesn't matter because you are introduces artificially some infrared stuff, and then you are going back when you're calculating LM sealed, and in this way you're not dependent on this infrared stuff. It doesn't mean that the problem infrared disappears because you still need to know for physical quantities what this large distance contributes. But okay, but still this. You can unravel. You can define what refers to short distances and which part is large distances. And it was important for our applications. Okay, so
excuse me.
Yeah.
Dimitri, sorry.
It's very good.
I mean, a few questions. Maybe all naive. First of all, the operators here. The local operators you do this OPE do not need to be gauge invariant. Each local of them, right? Doesn't need to be gauge invariant.
Yeah, right. No, right. But I didn't mention this gauge invariant. But yes. No, I mean in this way, when you construct an operator, you are accounting for the all symmetries of the theory. No, but it is mostly. Not because you cannot include other operators, because when you will calculate this running, you will see that you know it's kind of different sectors. Right? So in this way, even you have unphysical operator, you can find out that if you started from gauge invariant, you will produce only gauge invariant. So in this sense, as operators, if you like the, it doesn't matter if coefficient for them is zero, right? So, so to the extent that your initial point was a good, then you are protected. Of course, technically it means that your procedure of calculation should not break gauge invariants, but it's like a check, right? If you will break it, you will get some operators which you know. And it was, I will come to construction of operator in a particular example, and people did spend some time about the question which operator to include, which is not include, and it is still sometimes there is some issues there, but I will mention some examples later on, Julian.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I think the answer will be no for each local operator, but the whole thing certainly should be gauge invariant, right?
So. Yeah, right. But I'm trying to say that your starting point is to start from gauge invariant initial Lagrangian, right? And then what I'm trying to say is that if you're not breaking, you know, gauge invariance by your procedure, then you're guaranteed to have running of operator coefficient also in the set of gauge invariant operators.
And when you do this OPE, you probably choose a certain energy scale to do these calculations of OPE, right? So the energy scale will be a certain energy scale. Then
what I called ultraviolet cutoff M, it is this energy scale, right? So when I'm saying M, that it means that all our energies are smaller when I'm calculating down, all our energies are smaller than M. Okay, so M, it is a normalization point. It is a way to see to denote which energies you are calculating. So in this way, you are not calculating anything above M, but you're calculating stuff which goes at momenta smaller than M. Okay, no, correspondingly you can talk in terms of distances. Yeah. So in this sense. I'm trying to make a point that this Wilson procedure, it is main part of this procedure is exactly separation of scale. So scales which are larger than something enter coefficient, right? Calculating scales which are larger distances or smaller momenta enters taking metric theorem of operators. So in this way, you're certainly separating scales, factorizing it to scales above and low and below.
But just make sure. So yeah. People also do this OPE, replace the local operator to maybe extend operator as well? maybe Wilson lines.
No, 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 no. This is what I'm talking. It's just here it is Euclidean short distances. So in this way, it's not line. I mean, it's always locality, but locality each time it is with accuracy 1 over m, 1 over ultraviolet cutoff, of course. Right? So, but when we are writing, For scales larger than 1 over m, it looks like local operators, right? It's not local in the sense that it is, you know, kind of was before kind of contributed distances shorter than this, but this one you did account for. So in this effect, actually, but it doesn't include any kind of line operators. No, it doesn't mean that you cannot introduce this, but it would be then some kind of new definition. I mean, for this purpose.
All right. Thank you. Maybe I'll add more later. Thank you.
Okay. Now to continue with the application, I'm starting from this so-called penguin. Mechanism of delta I equal 1/2 enhancement, and I'm not sure. No, I mean, okay, it used to be part of education, but I'm not sure how many people now going through this particle physics in terms of immunology of this K decays. Okay, so I'm apologizing to people, to many of you who knows all this stuff, but still trying to recollect this all time. So this our SVZ team started to do this SVZ team, which I mean Vali Zakharov, Misha Schiffman. We started to work on QCD effect for weak process in 1973. Okay, the paper I'm mostly talking about later on, it's was published, first one was 1975. So you see how long ago it was. And the issue with non-leptonic weak decays of strange particles was that the amplitude of short-lived neutral kn to pi plus pi minus it was much larger than the amplitude of charge kind decaying to pi plus pi zero. Okay, here it's as a slide you can see this 450 is a ratio of widths, but okay, even if you take square root, it would be 22. Or what, I mean, so the ratio of amplitude it is. More than 20. The difference between phenological difference between these two type of decays is you see that neutral K and K plus, of course, member of the same isomultiplet as well, and pi plus, pi minus, pi zero also members of multiplet. But you can see that in case of pi plus, pi minus decay, the change of isotopic spin could be 1/2 because isospin of K it is 1/2, isospin of pi is 1. So in pi plus pi minus system, it could be isospin either 0 or 2. Okay, so change of isospin either 1/2 or 3/2. But for the lower one, pi plus pi zero, there is no isospin zero clearly because projection of spin is one. So this the K plus is a pure 3/2 changes of spin. Okay, and this dominance of delta I 1/2 is kind of evident in this. I mean that it very strong effect, and it is indeed we can argue that it is due to strong interaction. For example, one of the first estimates for this process was made by Julian Schwinkel in 1964. And he used kind of factorization of non-leptonic amplitude because you have a theory which is current multiplied by current. So if you do factorization, then you can relate non-leptonic amplitude as expressed as a product of two semi-leptonic. Okay. Then you calculate in both cases. See how pi plus pi minus the k and pi plus pi zero the k. But then in this kind of simple factorizable picture, the ratio would be 9 to 4 instead of 450. Okay, for the amplitude would be 3/2. For the ratio of amplitude, so it's clear strong enhancement of that I won't have because I talking about enhancement not because you can say aha maybe delta I C half is small no. This Schwinger estimate for C half is of the right order of magnitude. So C half is okay, but not delta I 1/2. Okay, so okay, Ken Wilson, introduced notion related to this about enhancement that saying that it could be some more singular behavior at short distances for 1/2 as compared with 3/2. But at that time, it was no kind of consistent theory of strong interaction even at short distances. So QCD did not exist yet at that time. So that's why it was difficult to check. Okay. Now, then QCD appeared. Okay. So in this way was asymptotic freedom was introduced and this quark and gluons and then soon after particularly in 1974 it was two different papers, one by Mary Kay Gaillard with Ben Lee and another by Guido Altarelli with Lucian Maiani. I could not kind of say the name without thinking about two of them who are passed. Ben Lee quite long ago and Guido Altarelli not so long ago, but still, okay. But Mary Kay and Luciana are still there, still around. Okay, so they found that there is this logarithmic Renin in QCD at short distances in application to this non-Neptunian decay. And they found that indeed this delta I 1/2 enhanced this transition, this logarithmic Renin, which defined by scale between mass of W boson and lambda QCD. So your initial Lagrangian for non-Newtonic weak interaction is given as a scale defined by W boson exchange. So when you are below, then it becomes local Lagrangian product of current. Okay, and then you can go all the way to lambda QCD. But the result, while logarithmic Renin is there, numerically or quantitatively, the effect occurs to be very modest, quite short, fell very much short from explanation for the ratio. So it was no, because of logarithm, it's not in large numbers, but together with this combinatoric numbers, although it appears to be not negligent, but not very important at all. So the new scale, which showed up already at that time, was the scale associated with heavy quark. Okay, and when I'm talking about 70s, it was C quark, Chang quark, which was accounted for because big quark and T quark still were not discovered. Okay, but C quark there, and C quark was important because when you're considering these loop corrections, so it was some kind of, I didn't discuss it in details on the slide, but because people realize long before this that there is a problem that if there is no chunk walk, then iteration of weak interaction, say, leads to for example, decay of long-lived KN to mu plus mu minus. And it's kind of quadratically depends on cutoff, and also neutral K and mass difference, long and short, also contains this kind of quadratic diversions. So was the reason to introduce this famous Jim mechanism for the cancellation of this. So Chan quark was not known there, but they suggested that there is another quark, and it was no standard model. So the understanding that it should be doublet in terms of weak interaction, like UD quark and strange quark and C quark, this was not known at that time. But they still suggested that it should be kind of also charged new quark similar to U quark with some mass, and then instead of quadratic divergence, you have say MC square minus MU square, which would limit the effect. Okay, and this cancellation was important for this, but when calculation of Runyon was logarithmic Runyon was calculated, they accounted for this cancellation in a sense that implied that cancellation is still workable. I mean that loops containing C quark in loops where C quark is going and U quark is going, this would be suppressed. What was our new point, which we realized, was that this statement is distance dependent. Indeed, for mu, which is below MW but much larger than mass of C quark, then it's certainly true. And then you have MC square minus mu square divided by Runyon and mu square. And if mu square, okay, whatever, or the MW, much larger than MC, then it's small quantity. However, when you're going to normalization point below MC, okay, and let's think that C quark is heavy enough, so heavy means that it's much, much larger than lambda QCD. So that there is a window of opportunity or between MC, below MC and above lambda QCD. And then Runyon in this range, it's a log of MC square or mu square, okay? So, but for some reason, they did not realize this, and it is what we did. And in this form, this so-called penguin mechanism appeared, and here in the slide you can see the diagram with the loop which shows how it would appear. So you see that you have strange quark and W boson interacts with the left-handed current, but we are considering scale much larger than mass of W. So in this way, you can contract this W connection. So it's you can say that these points, initial point for W propagator and final point are spatially very close. Okay, so but then there is a loop. So the loop becomes very much similar to polarization operator, right? Because you have this upper points connected and this one, and then in this kind of loop you have either U quark or C quark. Okay, and as I said, that if we are if we would be at scales much larger than MC, then this Jim mechanism would give us this suppression. However, when we are below C, then we can say that it is like propagation of only U quark and mass of C quark X as a upper limit in the log. So you have a log of MC square divided by, if you go all the way down, would be divided by MU. But okay, you should not go all the way down. It would be MC square divided by mu square. Okay, And moreover, on the other side of this polarization operator, whatever, you see a gluon and gluon coupled to quarks, but this is gluon which is appears in the form of operator d mu f mu nu, d mu g mu nu. Okay, I did not write it. So it means that this gluon line is contracted too. So it d mu g mu nu, so it's a it is a source of gluon, and the source of gluon contains this all the quarks, of course. But what is crucial for our purposes was that it contains also a right-handed quark. Not only, of course, it contains also left-handed, but this new type of operator appears because now you start from left-handed current and you come into operator which contains right-handed quarks as well. Okay, okay. And no, here it's a little bit pictures of the history that. It's a diagram which we wrote in 1975, and John Ellis, he wrote in his 1977 paper with Mary K. Gaillard, Dmitry Naunopoulos, and Serge Ruda, and Colin Penguin. You can see how he wrote it, but he has some bet with Melissa Franklin that he will use the word penguin in the paper. So this way he realized this idea. Okay. So now I'm trying to give a little bit more detail. I'm trying to understand. No, okay. Nobody interrupted me. So does it mean that nobody could follow this, or what does it mean, Julian?
Arkady, maybe I could interrupt you, and sorry, my question is going to be ignorant. So I'm not intimately familiar with QCD. Could you tell the difference? What is the difference between the left and the right quarks? And why is it that there is a distinction in the diagram above? Is it just only the left quarks decay?
No, I mean, in QCD, I mean, for light quarks, I mean, like U and D, you can say that you are close to chiral limit where their mass is zero, okay? Mm-hmm. Then you have in QCD, you have this, if let's say U, D, and S quark, let's say that all of them light, so close to chiral limit, then you have this chiral SU3 cross SU3 symmetry, SU3 left. So it's like independent species, left-handed and right-handed. Okay, original operators were completely left-handed because the original W current was left-handed. Okay, what I am trying to to refer to in terms of penguin, that it is a way how completely left-handed operator will produce operator containing right-handed quarks. Okay, because what we are trying, our point is that matrix element of these new operators would be enhanced as compared with matrix element of only left-handed operators. Okay, so in this sense, you can view left and right as like a different species, because in massless image they are, you have
construction, right?
And this one, right? Okay.
I see. So I guess the piece of physics that I was missing is the fact that in the weak electroweak theory, the operators, the physical one, the kaons and the pions, they're all left-handed. Is that why you're saying that the physical
in original standard model, all non-Newtonic interaction are product of left-handed current?
Okay, yeah, that's sorry. That's the and again, apologies for the question. That's trivial from high energy perspective.
Right, but you see, as I said, that you see this here is combination that asymptotic freedom on one hand, and we will see that smallness of mass of quarks is important. In 75 when we did this, all these ideas were quite new. You know that. In your generation, probably in particle physics, everybody is already used to the point that quarks are very light. But it was not that trivial at that time. So people did not think much about massless quarks because everybody knew that there is no kind of this extremely light quarks, but then was the realization, they say mass of pi n squared is proportional to the mass of quark, whatever, but it's also came later. So in certain sense, so it was say Gell-Mann, Frisch, whatever, this new point that light quarks small mass for Gell-Mann came later than he insisted on the SUC because SUC symmetry, which he did much earlier. So it funny by itself. Okay, but anyway, here it is example of effective Lagrangian. I'm trying to understand that maybe I'm moving too slow, but still, let me still demonstrate some equations. That here it is the original Hamiltonian for weak interaction. It contains mixing element from CKM matrix, which moves strange quark to U quark, and then U quark to D quark, as you saw on the diagram. But it is given by delta S equal one. So the strange is changing by one units. Then the operator there, okay, and then we discuss this hierarchy of scale. that MW much larger than MC, MC much larger than N lambda QCD, then distances which are larger than one of MC, you would have only UDS quark, which are light quarks, but in this definition, implying that their masses are smaller than lambda QCD. Okay, and also there is a gluon field, and it is the only material for these operators. So when you're in the range of this small mu smaller than MC, okay. So then you can calculate all these four Feynman operators according to this SU3L called SU3 light symmetry, okay. And then here it is the list. So you can see four operators which comes from original Lagrangian. All of them are containing only product of left-handed current. What is written on the right, it is their features under SU3, cross SU3, and it, all of them are singlets of SU3, right? Representation under SU3 left are written explicitly, and also written which as a spin component, I mean, delta I equal 1/2 or 3/2 enters, okay. Then, because of this penguin, two new operators will show up, which I written below, 5 and 6. And it is this, no, I mean, the way they appeared, it is reflected by that diagram, this mixing appears this way. And you can see that they are also explicitly SU3 right singlets, because all quarks are entering. But in terms of left-handed, they also are octet and contain delta I, refers to delta I equal 1/2, those new operators, okay? Here it is an example of Runyon. I do not trying to put much attention, but you can see here Runyon of coefficient, first four coefficient in the range above MC. So it's coefficient at MC, and Runyon comes from the range above MC. And you can see in this Runyon that also existence of big quark is accounted, because Runyon is defined by power of Runyon alpha written here, but coefficient in this asymptotic freedom B depends on number of layers. So whether you're above B or below B, it would be a different coefficient. B is written here as well. I mean, so you see, linear depends on number of active layers. Then you need to go from MC to below MC, and it is mixing matrix, which is written here. And in this matrix, you can see that there are elements which are in this corner in this corner, which mixed left-handed with operator containing right-handed quarks. Okay, okay, and so we calculated this all this mixing. We in perturbative calculation gives us coefficient relatively small for new operator like C5 equals say about 0.06. Because mass of C quark is not that large, so the range is not this logarithmic range below MC is not and it results itself in a relatively small coefficient. However, you know, it is a range where you know probable non-perturbative effect becomes important. So it could be that even coefficients are not given by perturbation theory. So phenomenologically, we use a few times larger coefficient, and phenomenology works very well for not only for K decays, but we also considered hyperant decays as well. So we developed as a good phenomenology, but we couldn't justify our coefficient was about like 0.2 rather than 0.06. Okay, now.
Arkady, quick question, sorry.
Yeah.
If you go back to your six operators.
Yeah.
You were saying 5 and 6 come from the penguin diagram.
Yes.
So. In that penguin diagram, there is a gluon exchange.
Yeah.
So that gluon is taken to be like a hard gluon. Is that how I should?
No. I did try to mention it before, Max, that it enters, it's like a polarization operator, and it enters as d mu, g mu nu. So you see that in this sense it's automatically hard because what you are seeing it is the source of this gluon. So there is no real propagation. You have this polarization operator proportional to Q square divided by 1/Q² and then it's while it's gluon, but there is no any long range there associated with it.
Got it. It's like you use equation of motion.
It's you use equation of motion, right? But even diagrammatically, it is Q squared divided by Q squared, so you can see it. Okay. So now I'm trying to mention a bit about this enhancement. We are talking about that it is repetition of the same operators, 5 and 6. And now you can use field identity. So you can move, say right-handed quarks to interchange with left-handed, and then what you will get, I did not write it, but it's what you will get, you will get the product left-handed multiplied by right-handed, and then it would be not a current, and it would be a density. So those operator 5 and 6 are those which are equivalent to product of densities. Okay, example like U bar gamma 5D, for example, appears after this field transformation. And then we are taking matrix element of this, in factorization approach, for example, matrix element appears of pi and goes between pi and vacuum of this operator. Okay. Now this operator U bar gamma 5D could be written as divergence of axial current. In the axial current matrix element, we know because it's defined by P mu nu decay and called F pi. F pi equals 135 MeV. And then this matrix element becomes F pi, the same as from the current, multiplying pi squared divided by mu over MD. And here it is this frog jumps into the water because M pi squared is proportional to mu plus MD. But the ratio, it is like 2 GeV. But say characteristic numbers there, like f pi, are much smaller, like say 135 MeV, or lambda QCD could be smaller than this. So in certain sense, 2 GeV is a large number, and it is this and it is not parametric, right? Because m pi square is a number, and this one, this ratio has a meaning of quark condensate. So essentially, it's like q bar q value. So it means that quark condensate numerically is sufficiently large. Okay. And it is a scale which kind of hidden in QCD. And it's what we are trying to play with, and we will find. I mean, I do not give you here detail of feminology. As I said, feminology rather well, but we need to enhance coefficient, which we could not justify because it's kind of we believe that it is some kind of non-perturbative stuff. However, what when they try to demonstrate that there is this non-perturbative enhancement sitting in this matrix element at large distances, and this non-perturbative enhancement associated with this hidden scale in QCD, which is in certain sense larger than lambda QCD. So you can say that all scales are proportional to lambda QCD, including this to GV, but it is numerical that existence of this larger scale. And in our later application, they try to prove that in glue balls built in glue balls, this internal scale even larger, a few times larger than this to GV. So there is this scale which are present and which is not as I said, not parametrical, but still important. Okay. So, let me see. So it's almost a little bit less than hour, but this other two applications would be shorter. But I did still try to discuss them. Anything about this penguin? Nobody would like to fly as penguin.
Please take your time. Don't no rush.
No, I am okay. Yeah, but I mean, but I'm. You see, I'm trying not to torture you. I mean, so that's why. I mean, for me, I need to hear that you're okay. Thank you. Another part of the story. So I talk.
Actually, let me ask the question. Sorry.
Yeah.
One in the beginning, I think you introduced penguin mechanism and possibly try to explain a ratio between the chi on decay, Ks and K plus, right? To
yeah.
Pi plus, pi minus, or pi plus, yeah. Pi zero. The ratio is 450.
Yeah.
And I wonder, just in case, how was that resolved? Maybe you can summarize again. Just make sure I really follow the ratio is obtained correctly from theoretical expectation that you say. Because that was the original motivation, right?
No. Okay. As I said, we cannot say that we gave a complete understanding what is there. So, in certain sense, if you like, it's like a hint, right? That we see that there are some non-perturbative phenomena encoded in this large matrix element, which should be taken into account. However, as I said, that perturbative calculation of coefficient was not very good, and it could be that in this way unravel what is perturbative and what is non-perturbative in this particular situation when C quark is not very heavy is not that simple. Because we can say that D meson, which are their masses, like 1.6 GeV in terms of physical masses. Mass of quark is even smaller, right? So it's not, it is larger than normal hadronic scale, but not tremendously large, right? So that's why, it's not a full understanding. However, for me, it was also very much in sex that people in the latest, they tried to calculate this ratio early on, you see, because it's extremely pronounced effect. You have ratio of 22 in the amplitude, right? So it looks like in terms of latency, it is a very proper object to explore. And it goes for look. I'm talking about 1975, and very early on they tried to apply latency, and I would say that only recently they started to claim that they are closing to this physically reasonable number. They could not get this 22 on the lattice. And you see, my physical point is that in certain sense, it could be that even on the lattice, they are missing some effect sitting at short distances. No, one signal of this is that, for example, results of lattice used to be dependent on what kind of improved lattice action you are using. When it depends, it means that you are sensitive to short distances, right? Okay, and it is, and when I am talking about this intrinsic scale, which is a larger scale, I mean that in gluons, which are kind of very short, right? Because we are talking about like 6 GeV there, not 2 GeV. Then even your lattice distance could be not enough. You see, to resolve this. So that's why I'm not sure. But it was indeed, very long story, and I'm not sure to what extent I didn't follow recently, but I did follow what they are doing for quite a time. Okay, now it's a different object, which I'm trying to discuss, and it was started in 78, 79. Okay, and our paper, short paper was published first in 78, but then we had the whole issue of nuclear physics in 79, which was include three papers, which covered the whole issue, and it was methods of QCD sum rules, and the notion I'm trying to emphasize is the notion of this gluon condensate in particular. So here it's example of Pearson operator product expansion for the product of current. Okay, it could be electromagnetic current, but it could be any current, because we are probing different quantum numbers by choosing different currents in terms of Hadron. So in this way, G mu is a generic notation. And this product of G mu is given by local, could be written as product of local operators multiplied by coefficient. But again, it is the same story as before. You see that Q, this Q, it is in our external momentum, which is say, let's say Euclidean, not to probe short Euclidean distance. But also, which is not shown here, it is this dependence on normalization point, right? So you can say that if Q is large, you can say that as initial normalization point, now instead of W boson mass, you can take say initial large Q and then see what's going on for operators below this point. So you again would have running of coefficient, and this could be done. So operators in this expansion could be ordered by canonical dimension and Lorentz spin, but we have in mind application to vacuumatic element of this product of currents. That's why we are talking about only spin zero. Okay, so it means that all those operators are spin zero operators, and moreover, if we talking about current which has conserved, then we can take factorize this tensor structure corresponding to this Q nu minus G mu Q square, which maintain transversality of the current. Okay, so okay, let's count some operators. So the first.
Sorry to interrupt. The operator O on the right hand side.
Yeah.
It's local operator.
Yeah, local operator. There. Yeah.
What point does it live at?
No, but you see, it's like before. We consider large Q, right? So of course, locality is approximate, right? It means that it is a normalization point. No, I mean, if you consider like three diagram, whatever, then it's a normalization point is one. It is Q itself. So it means that when I'm saying local, it means that for distances larger than one over Q, I can view operator as local one, but for for distances larger than 1/q. No, so in this way, it's like previous discussion. You see, you have this Lagrangian, it was some normalization point, and then you're discussing what would be at lower normalization point. Here, you can rewrite it as terms of Lagrangian. You can say that you have kind of external field coupled to this current, right? And then discuss, this iteration of this interaction of external field with the current in Lagrangian, and in this way you can say that you are calculating this effective Lagrangian for lower normalization point. So in this, but now you have external field. Okay, so this is the difference. Okay, mm-hmm. So now I am trying to discuss this operators, and the leading operators is identity operators, and then when we are calculating coefficient for this operator, it is the same as perturbation theory, because matrix element of this operator is unity. Okay, but then you can discuss next operators. Next by dimension. It could be operator, for example, Q bar Q, if we have fermions, but dimension three, but because of chirality, it enters with coefficient proportional to M, and let's say that quarks are masses. So then the first operator in chiral limit would be this operator G mu square, okay? Where G mu, it is field strength for gluon field. So it's the first operator, and it's already immediately, if you like, prediction, because it means that there is no dimension two. So all this power correction starts from 1/q^4. Dimension, the higher power of Q by which this corresponding coefficient would be containing. So this the gluon coefficient would be 1/q^4. Okay. Now, what was the main point? That normally we would say, we are sitting at like short distances, for example, and in short distances, then remember that alpha collections, it is 1/log of Q. And this correction we are talking a power of 1/q^4 and higher if dimension is higher. Okay, so you would say forget about this power correction, and it was mostly done before. Okay, so people didn't discuss power correction because parametrically you can say that log of Q, of course, is much more important than 1/log of Q correction are much more important than 1/q zeros. But we did try to argue that actually in this range where there is this kind of transitional range, power corrections are important. It's hypothesis. So in this way, we cannot prove this, but we can try to use it. So we can say what we started from. We said that let's imagine that you have this matrix element of G square operator, and we call it gluon condensate over vacuum. Okay, in power correction we have coefficient which we can calculate perturbatively, coefficient for this operator, which I mentioned 1/q^4, but you can calculate this without problem in perturbative range. It doesn't mean that coefficient are given by perturbation theory, because there it also could be non-perturbative phenomena, but it is this part of the hypothesis that we say coefficient are perturbative and matrix element, which are distances larger, are non-perturbative, right? No, because they count large distances, they are indeed non-perturbative. And to illustrate it in the diagram, here it is example, if you can see the diagram, of polarization operator, and normally you would say that perturbation theory in even this gluon correction, every moment in the loop is of the order of external Q. Okay, then it is a part of perturbation theory, and it is a correction to coefficient for unit operator. Okay. However, even in the diagram, you can find the range where momentum, for example, of this exchange gluon K much smaller than Q. there is such a range. Of course, it's not the main range, because the main would be Cape of order of Q. But let why this range? Because given the action are strong in this range, so the range of small k is not given by this diagram. It's non-perturbative. Okay, so that's why let's limit ourselves by only to range where momenta are large. Then everything where momenta is large in this diagram are contracted into the point, and only k, which is a small momenta or large distances. Okay, so you have this kind of tadpole here, where this tadpole does represent nothing else but this matrix element of Gemini square, because operator in this bold point, it is just Gemini square would be this operator, and then you are taking like matrix element of this operator in the infrared range. Okay. We cannot trust it because we do not know it, but we can use it as phenological entrance. Okay, so there were some idea about this gluon condensate related to instanton, and also it was Savidi Matinyan who introduced this kind of vertex type of condensate. So when you're trying to do this infrared structure explicitly, okay. But in our procedure, we are not kind of trying to find out what is the infrared structure of the theory, what is the large distances. We are trying to use it as kind of a phenological parameter of gluon condensate. Okay. Besides gluon operators, there are other operators, for example, for Fermion operator, which is dimension 6, so it's additional 1 over Q square, which also we accounted for. Okay, and then to get some particular application, we use some a little bit more of procedure. Namely, I apologize that there's maybe again some old formula, but let's say we are taking matrix element of a vacuum. And this stuff we call polarization operator P of Q square after separating out, factorizing out this tensor structure. So for this operator, we can write for polarization operator pi, we can write a dispersion relation, the standard one. And if in case of say electromagnetic current, imaginary part of this polarization delay would nothing but say could be written as integral imaginary part equal to what's called ratio R, which is ratio of V plus E minus to head and divided by mu plus mu minus a cross section. No, and it's easy to calculate in the leading order, it's just sum of quark charges square, 3, it is a number of colors. Okay. Of course, you can use other currents as well. So, but then it would be a different R, I mean, but also easy to calculate. So imagine part in quark language, it is kind of simple, like constant in this chiral limit is very simple one. Okay. Now, we are trying to, and it was important procedure for us to improve this integration, because integration, one of people, one of the first notion which people Steven Weiberg and others discussed was that you have this physical polarization operator, and you are saying that it is equal polarization operator given by quark in perturbation theory. So you have this R for quarks. I wrote example of R-partonic. Okay, and then you are saying the integral of physical imaginary part equal to integral dispersion integral for partonic part. Okay, and it's called duality. Okay, it was called duality. What we were trying to find out using this power correction, what is the range of duality? Where it's ended up? I mean, where, because what is transitional behavior? But for this purpose, first we use this so-called Borel transform. Okay, there are different form how to write it. One of the form is written here as differentiation kind of many times over Q square multiplied by corresponding power of Q square, and then you will find out that it transform one over s plus q square into to the exponent. No, this Bayesian transform gives you this. So it's much better convergent in terms of integration over s, and the range is given by parameter m instead of q. Okay. It has another advantage that for power correction, which is one over q square in certain power, it also gives you factorial for higher powers, gives you one over k minus one factorial. So it, the improvement on both sides. On the physical side, you have better convergence. On the expansion in one over q square powers, you have better convergence too. Okay, so now. Heat is a kind of simple example of applications that you have this imaginary part, integral physical one equal to partonic one multiply by this first term alpha s over pi, it's a perturbative correction, and then alpha s mu mu square vacuum attenuate, it is gluon condensate correction. Okay, I did not type example, but if you apply it to say current with isospin one current with quantum numbers of Romeisen, we calculated first step part we calculated was residue of Romeisen area, because integral over S gives you area under the peak, and you calculate the area, so it means you're calculating coupling constant for Romeisen going to photon, and occurs to be g square or g rho square over 4 pi was equal to 2 pi divided by e, where e is natural base of natural logs. So it was numerically, it epistemologically works very well. Okay, but then you can people apply it to different residues at different masses for that, and so this QCD sum rules became very much in use because it's easy to use, and everybody can apply it to different subjects. So it was some number of successful application, but situation was not that simple because in certain channels it was not that working well. For example, for spin zero, zero minus, so pseudoscalar channel, for example, where pion is, it was very interesting story because in axial current channel, psi gamma mu gamma phi psi, it works very well where f pi is, and but in channel when you are taking a kind of divergence of this for pseudoscalar, it doesn't work, and it corresponds to that point that. For example, this so-called instanton stuff was become important. So some stuff which is not sitting in perturbation theory, and it is the range where, in certain sense, you need to go for non-perturbative parts in coefficient as well. In this particular channel, okay. So it was this kind of issues as well. So we did try to work out from phenomenology of different channels where these corrections, instantonic corrections, large, where it's not small, but okay, it's another story. Okay.
Sorry, Kadi, would you mind if I ask you a question?
Sure. On the opposite, I need some questions.
Right. So, Arkady, could you please go maybe, I don't know, 2-3 slides back where you showed the expansion for the phenomenological Hamiltonian in terms of the OPEs? Yes, this one.
Yeah.
So can I ask a question which is maybe not directly related to this particular application, but the question is as follows. If I look at the operators O's, right, that you're exposing in, you're using intuition from diagrammatics to find out what these operators are, right? And as you pointed out, the lowest order is the identity, and then you skip the Q, and the next one actually comes as G mu nu, correct? And you could imagine building this up. Could you reflect on how this is similar or dissimilar to what one does, let's say, in two-dimensional quantum field theories? Of course, there the situation is much more controlled in a sense, but even there, for a given theory, one needs to exercise care figuring out what are the primaries, what are the descendants, which operators actually enter on the right-hand side of this expansion, right? And so here, because we don't have this two-dimensional structure, we don't have this holomorphic, non-holomorphic, or anti-holomorphic vertex operator algebra, To what extent is this under control? Like, how can we be sure that there are no, you know, in some six-order power, there is some operator O, which is much more important than, let's say, the identity or gene mu squared. Is that no some sense?
Yeah, no. As I said, look, for example, operator for fermionic operator numerically ought to be not less important than you know for application. Than say gluon condensate operate. I mean there because it's also this numerical coefficient which enter in which order operator coefficient appear. So in this sense, in fermion it appears in at the three level at in say for example G mu square operator appears upon the loop. So it gives you. You numerical so for particular applications, скажем, say it was important. But regarding to two-dimensional theory, we use sigma model as example where we check explicitly, you know, the procedure. So I mean, not in terms of holomorphicity, but particular say in large N, for example, large N sigma model like CPN or ON model, and we saw that large M justify our procedure. I mean that in the leading order, that it can consistent with no what we know in because this two-dimensional model are solvable in large M, right? So a result you're consistent, and you see that there say. For example, like d mu n square condensate plays a role. I mean, instead of say gluon condensate was this d mu n square. There are some phenomena which people discuss in terms of running, which refers to what's called Lenormalon. Okay, so there is infrared Lenormalon. Okay, and it will show up, but. It was not inconsistencies with our procedure, but in the leading order it was very simple check. I mean very easy to see you know that is consistent this non-perturbative Dmn square condensate it is the one which gives you masses to the particle you know you started from Goldstones right and then you get this right. So in this way, we even have a special review about the dimensional model in you know in this respect. But it wasn't about the homomorphicity, but partly I don't know. I still have a little bit of time. I will give you example of this homomorphicity in the next application, if you don't mind. I mean, Julian, is it okay that I mean I will use this 10 minutes for.
Don't worry, I speak for 3 hours, so you can take. It's really
not. Arkady, but just to double check. So what you're saying is that depending on the application, depending on what operator one is interested in, the values of the coefficients, some of them may be bigger, smaller, and you know you have to, in some sense, exercise. It seems like it's very much model dependent, correct? Depending what operator you're looking at, and there is no formal. Structure of like vortex operator algebra. You can like you don't know ahead of time what are the relevant fields, right? There is no sense like in a two-dimensional CFT where there is a finite number of primaries and you know that any operator right is a sum of only those operators and nothing else. It's in principle in infinite series.
But look, in the case of kind of solvable two-dimensional model, you know more. Because what we are trying to do, we are trying to avoid knowledge of infrared, right? Because where you have some interaction, what we are doing is kind of simple procedure, right? We are calculating coefficient in the range where coupling is small, right? So there is no problem to calculate coefficient in this range. And then we are trying to do the knowledge without going into details of infrared, just trying to say that, let's say that it is matrix element of this operator which hide this all this non-perturbative nature in it, right? And this factorization of the stuff is not that it doesn't mean that it always would work, right? Because as I said, it could be that coefficient are non-perturbative as well. But it is indeed depends on particular application and even in two-dimensional model, as I said, that I mean Okay, in the leading order, it was justified by Lachen. Okay, in the next order, it was some subtleties related to Leonard Malone's, but this you can unravel still. I mean, okay, but it, of course, what we are saying is much more of knowledge of the structure of the mode than just, you know, kind of factorizing this. But the idea was just very simple of factorizing short distance into coefficient and non-perturbative into matrix element. Okay, now. Okay.
Yeah. So sorry, just to very quickly follow up on Andres' question. If you go back to the to the JMU JNU, if I don't have an integral, right? If I just do position space JMU of x JNU of zero, there is kind of position space OPE, right? I can write down how. But if you just integrate that, you probably get nonsense. Is that?
No. It's okay because we are talking about Euclidean range. So if you are talking, we are talking about Euclidean X and Euclidean Q as well, right? Then relations that you know, kind of correspondence between 1/Q and corresponding X. So it's just a problem of I don't know, technical convenience. What is easier to write in? No, it could be some subtleties there, but I do not think that there is any kind of real problem between using it in so we can instead use singularity in X space. I mean, instead of so you see that expansion of 1/Q square would be expansion in power of X, but there it would be like power of X multiplied by say log of X. Right? I mean, singularity should be there. I mean,
but you can run maybe into trouble if Do the integrals converge in the UV? Maybe.
This one, no, I mean, in this particular example, which we are talking about, I did not put the attention, your attention to this, but remember I did this, the integral, dispersion integral for imaginary part, it's logarithmic, right? Because imaginary part is a constant divided by S plus Q squared integral ds, so it's logarithmic, right? And this is a kind of Cauchy linearization log. It's not a big deal. But when we did this Borel transform, we even got rid of this because we got the integral with exponent. And this is just sitting. You see, what was convenient that it is fully sitting in for s smaller than m square exponentially, right? So you do not need to worry about any. Okay, now of course you can do it with log, but you see, our point was that we are trying to relate non-perturbative phenomena with low energy resonance structure. So for example, we imply that there is only one resonance. Okay, in Romeisen channel, okay, and we see that mass of residue in the mass predicted. Okay, however, when you're going, for example, to glue balls, it's not that simple because this non-perturbative scale correspond to much larger masses, and there this simple structure that is just one resonance, for example, also does not work, right? So indeed it's application dependent, but it's a reflection of this existence of this different scales inside of QCD. Okay, so that's why I think that it could be in different models as well. Okay.
Okay.
This large application, it was.
Maybe let me also have, actually Hank has one question. I also have one. I don't know. Maybe I go ahead first and then Hank can ask. So my question is more conceptual. Just make sure the technique you use. It seemed to me you use three things. The first thing is simple as the asymptotic freedom, which is the weak coupling at a high energy.
Yeah.
One thing. The second thing is that you also use some non-perturbative effects from maybe muon or the Poisson condensate. That's another regime of the QCD, but some physics you also use that. And you mix between the first one, the second one, which means the weak coupling physics and the strong dynamic physics. And then the third one is the OPE. Is that the kind of mix of techniques that's the things you use, try to extract maybe some physics out of these three tools?
Right, but look, I did try to illustrate it as a diagram. You see, you have this diagram with the gluon exchange, okay? And I'm saying that let's consider the range where this internal gluon moment is small, kind of infinite, much smaller than external Q, which gives us initial scale, okay? So when you, there is a, what we are trying to say is that we do not know what is gluon moment in this small q, right? Small k, because it is non-perturbative range for sure, right? So what we did, but factorizing we can do. So we are saying that all distances above 1 over q square, 1 over q are sitting in this, in the local point. Okay, and it is our operator G minus square effectively, or whatever operator here would be G minus square, because there are two gluon coming out of this operator. So in this way, G minus square. And then we are not calculating what in the infinite, because we do not know non-perturbative range. But factorization, it is our main instrument. We are saying, we found a short distance coefficient, and we did not find a value of matrix element. You see, so to quote condensate refers to the same. You see that when we consider, say, four Feynman operators, it's the same story as with quark condensate. Even when you introduce non-zero mass, for example, then you have operator M of quark multiplied by Q bar Q, okay? And again, the same factorization, would be following, because we are not explaining quark condensate. We are just using phenomenological value of this condensate. And, however, coefficient for operator MQ Q bar Q, at short distances, we certainly can find out because it is perturbative, right? So it is parametrical that at large Q we can separate scales, okay? But then what is going on when you diminishing Q? Then of course it becomes more complicated.
Okay. Yeah, I was wondering. The thing I was going to ask first is there some weakness of this approach? Maybe sometimes there may be intermediate region that you cannot use either. Or the mix between the strong and
the weak. So it could, no, but look, when we are applying this in QCD, for example, some rules, in this way, we are implying that there is a window of opportunity where this factor coefficient could be taken perturbatively and matrix element non-perturbatively. But it's not guaranteed. So it's not that we can say, aha, it works, because it means that you are going down and you still can reach this window where you can use this procedure of factorization, right? It could be that there is no window. And I did try to say that in certain channels, you see that this non-perturbative correction coefficient are important, right? So in this way, there is no guarantee for this QCD sum rules. However, in this example, which I tried to discuss in terms of supersymmetric theory, and probably Misha tomorrow would tell you much more about the supersymmetric series. But I'm trying to demonstrate the same idea of separating scales, which I think it's important.
All right, great, thanks. Yeah, Hank has a question.
Yeah, sorry. This might be kind of off topic, but I'm actually very interested in what you mean by the vortex type of the gluon condensate.
Yeah. No, a vortex type, it means that when you, it is some particular model of infrared structure. You see that this, what Savidi and Matinyan suggested, remember this, how it's called. Then it was people in Copenhagen, like Nielsen and others, who continued this stuff, right? That you have some structure which tells you how gluon condensate is made. Okay, in a simple form, if you say that, like say homogeneous field or whatever, then you can just use it to say what is matrix element over G minus square of this for this condensate is, right? But and we are not pretending that we know. Okay, and or even if you have some instantonic model, we also can try to calculate in this model the mu square matrix element. But okay, and in certain sense, we try to avoid this because I mean this. I would not say, I would say that we were kind of very much doubtful about this vertex type of vacuum, but not for the. How to say for our procedure, we did try to avoid answering the question. You see, so I'm not sure which direction you would like to go. I mean, but okay. So in this sense.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. So in this sense, essentially, we do not know the answer to the question. But on personal side, I was doubtful about possibility of this type of vacuum. But I would say that still, in terms of the very existence of condensate, it's certainly example the same way as instantonic calculation is also example. But however, it's difficult to make it kind of theoretically justifiable. It is a problem. Trying to go back to this notion of Wilsonian action, and in particular. The separation of scale appears in such form that, that there are some stuff which people are kind of sometimes mixed, because there's a notion of effective action, which we would like to call gamma of mu, which is action which is equivalent of calculating of amplitude, one particle reducible amplitude, because it's like generator of this vertices, one particle reducible vertices, and this is equivalent of amplitude, and in this stuff you are not using Wilsonian expansion, because in this way you're just calculating in external background field or whatever, you're calculating the answer, okay. When we are doing Wilsonian action, Wilson action, then we are saying the following: let's do this operator expansion, which we discussed, and then let's calculate this action in terms of write down this operator in the point mu, and then calculate all range of momenta smaller than mu as matrix element or path integral of with this action. Okay. And then we will get to this gamma of mu, which is irreducible amplitude. Okay, but this separation is important for us because it gives possibility to separate momenta larger than mu and smaller than mu. Okay, so in this way, together with Viktor Novikov, our SVZ team calculated, for example, when what's called an SVZ beta function. Result is written here in terms of T of G and T of R. It is this indices of corresponding representation of adjoint and fundamental, or whatever representation is. G means that CT it comes from gluon field, and other terms comes from meta field. Okay, and in the denominator, it is also gluonic this geometrical progression in alpha over pi. Okay, so you see that the structure of beta function is kind of interesting that in certain sense besides this geometrical progression, it looks like a one loop result. Okay, and we did try to understand it. So original derivation was based on instantal calculus. But the instant was not as dynamic of the series like a probe. You have calculation in external field, okay? Instantonic field was an external field, okay? And then we did try to find the perturbative interpretation for this same derivation in terms of this Wilsonian action, okay? Wilson action. So here it's a reminder that action in supersymmetric series has a form of integral over superspace of W square. And the second term integral over D4 theta over whole space fermionic variables which is the meta, okay, and meta, mass of the meta here is zero, okay. So this W, which is kind of I don't know, say Gluyena square in the leading term, it is the first part, it is a chiral part, and it is related to this holomorphicity very much, because this part is holomorphic part. The second part with the meta is not, I mean, because it's D4 theta. So there is no this difference between theta, both theta and theta bar enters. Okay. Now, when is a holomorphic part, this first part, then we would argue that it is doesn't get normalized beyond one loop. That it with instanton, it was also similar, but it was an instantoneous calculation of the amplitude. Here it is, we have this separation scale mu, and we have this first part, this coefficient for W square, which is a chiral part and which is a holomorphic part in this sense. So. Then in one loop, the result is very simple. It contains this 3T of G from gluon with coefficient, and T of R is coefficient for meta field. Okay, now, when we introduced higher orders than one loop, then we would say that for example, for the meta, and it, we did try to verify that for what happened for the meta, that higher loops are from the meta are due to existence of renormalization of the meta term, which we'll call Z. And Z is not holomorphic quantity, so it enters under log, so it was log of M0 over mu, and now it's in log M0 over mu in Z, okay? And it is reflection of higher loops, okay? So which contribution to running of Kauplin due to the meta loops in higher orders. Okay, was more difficult part, which was related how all higher loops by gluon enters. Okay, and essentially our consideration leads to the 4 points that effectively additional part would be this T of G log of G square. No, we can put it also under log, but whatever. It's additional piece which reflects running of G square itself in the higher order. In terms of instant calculation, you have kind of very convenient part when you have zero modes and non-zero modes. Non-zero modes cancel out, and zero modes has its own renormalization, and it's where you can see that for gluon it would be effectively log of G square, and for meta would be log of Z. Okay, this you but this, so there is this stuff, but then you can say that, okay, that accounting for this part, this you can, if you added this log of Z and log of G square, then we can see that this exact beta function is produced. Okay, so it's, but you see, it's again was important that we said that this higher loops comes from infrared. Below point mu, and everything else, and one loop comes from above mu. So in this way, one loop nature of this holomorphic coupling is preserved. However, because of existence of non-holomorphic, this taking down involves, say, log of Z, which is non-holomorphic effect by itself, but it appears there. It's also related to this old, my last comment is about this old puzzle we formulated Ferrara Zumina about comparison energy momentum tensor with diversion of axial current. And the question was that theta mu mu is proportional to full beta function, contains higher loops in generically at d mu and mu, it is Adler-Bardeen, seems that there is no correction due to higher loop, so it's just one loop. Okay, the way we answered this question was that in this operator language, both are one loop. the mu mu and theta mu mu. Okay, and higher loops appears later as a matrix element, and in this way, okay, depending on procedure, you can, you know, it makes consistent statement. So in some sense, depends on procedure, you can have higher loops in the mu and mu as well. But then, okay, then it's a question how procedure in theta mu mu related to the mu and mu. But initial part, this Wilson part, is would be one loop in both cases anyway. So, and it's convenient that in operator form, you are not going beyond one loop in both cases. Okay, I'm sorry that I'm above my time. Let's see, yeah, by 13 minutes. Okay, but, and I hope that you're still surviving. Does not look that you are sure about this.
Keep going.
No, I'm done.
I see. Okay, thank you. Are you sure? Maybe you can. No more slides.
No, not in the sense that I still alive. Okay, but but I stopped the process.
All right. Okay, so there are no more slides. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, Akadi. Question from the audience, comments, please feel free.
I stand to add my apologies that, you know, that, okay, maybe I could do it in a different, better way, but whatever. I was hoping on you, that you will stop me. Okay.
No, it's great.
Yeah, really no, I think that Misha Schiffman should ask a question, but he didn't.
Unmute yourself. Misha, you need to unmute.
You did not unmute yourself, Misha.
Yeah. Misha, we cannot hear you. Yeah, you need to unmute.
I just noted that I know this stuff. Why should I ask questions? It should be rather silly. It's intended for other listeners.
No. You would be able to demonstrate that we have disagreement even now. Right?
Well, that's good. You know, out of disagreement, some truth.
But I did not tell you know the story. For example, how difficult. So we started with Misha, as I said, in 1973. You were still graduate at that time, right?
Yeah, I was grad student, yes.
Right, and when we in 75, say, published this paper about Penguin,
yeah,
was a short in variant in jet letters, and then we tried to publish in nuclear physics. And we spent a year and a half trying to make it possible, and we managed eventually today in 1977, it was published in Center 75 with the help of David Gross, who was on editor board at that time. Yeah, so because people could not kind of accept the idea, so it went to different referees, and probably because we wrote in very concise way, right, so that idea did not penetrate masses. Then at some point, I think it was Mary Kay Gaillard who first said that it's kind of interesting.
You know, I just now look in the chat and somebody writes to everything. We love hearing about physics archaeology. So Arkady, you are telling people about physics archaeology.
okay so you can say that you dig out no, it's still body, it's still not how it's in Russian skelet. No
skeleton,
not a skeleton yet. Okay, thanks. Say my thanks to everybody for your patience. Okay, and but I hope that still, you know, even sometimes the archaeology makes sense.
Спасибо, Аркадий.
Yeah. Okay.
Maybe let me ask something really naive. I just want to make sure the actual current divergence non-conservation related to energy momentum tensor here?
Yeah.
Is there some kind of a conformal anomaly or something?
Yeah, yeah, right, right. Theta mu mu is conformal anomaly. The mu mu, it is axial current, but in supersymmetric Lewis dynamics, it is they are related by supersymmetry, and it is was the problem that if they are related by supersymmetry, how it could be that higher loops in one case and no higher loops in the other case.
And just to make sure. So this is a supersymmetry story in the part three. How is that? How is this related to the part one and part two? Maybe in some way.
Say it again.
The part three is about this supersymmetry theory, and you have this NSVZ beta function calculation. I wonder whether there are some physics applications for this, maybe similar to what part one and part two did.
Yeah, right. I just mentioned this Villar-Zumino puzzle. Because it's in our understanding, it is kind of related to the same issue, that if we believe that this operator approach a la Wilson is okay, then everything is one loop, and then there is no problem to that this supersymmetry dictates this relation, right? So then it's consistent. It was consistent in one loop from the very beginning, but then people ask how it could be then it diverges in higher loops, that in one case it is higher loops in the other case, and we are trying to say that it is just like taking metric theorem, and then depending on how this starts, higher loops indeed could appear, then you can check how you did your regularization in infrared in one case in the mu mu, and how to do it in theta mu mu. So the higher loops could be different depending on this procedure, but still the theorem itself that in operator language is just one loop, I think it helps a lot.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Right.
Hi, Arkady.
Yeah.
This is Mitat. How are you?
As I did try to say that I'm not skeleton yet.
Okay, you made some interesting remarks about renormalons versus, operator product extension. At least to my perspective, a natural way to look to the renormalon is through the window of the operator product expansion. So yep. In some sense, probably historically the best way to justify renormalon is operator product expansion.
I think there is a difference between infrared and UV renormalon. For infrared renormalon, I agree completely, right?
Correct, yeah.
But with UV, I think that the result is not completely clear, for UV renormalon. Right,
so. Yeah, you are right. For the IR what I'm saying was all for IR renormalon.
As I can completely agree. And we did try to answer this partly to discuss this three-dimensional model, like sigma model. So I do not think that we have disagreement with you about this.
No, not at all. Yeah. Okay. Thanks for the nice talk, by the way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Also, because Arkady was apologizing in the beginning, but there's really no reason to apologize for talking about, known result. Even in stating the organized and nice way, really is good for the community. I hope this video posts online and some people might find it useful. Another thing, I won't call it physics archaeology, but anyway, but we also try to put people to talk about this Fermilab muon G minus 2 result actually in the upcoming summer seminar. So if you have an interest or if you have a suggestion on the speakers, please let me know. Actually, I find the Fermilab speakers and also some people from IAS, they will talk about this.
G minus 2, I was involved for a long time. So in this way, I can participate discussion because
I think, can I come back.
On the side, I think there is some kind of capitalization of theoretical opportunity to create. So I'm not talking about experimental result, but on the theoretical side, I think that accuracy is not the one which is usually cited.
Yeah, okay. All right, so no more questions? If not, then we can thank Arkady again. And people can still stay in the...
Thank you very much. Okay, thank you.